In America, we are told we have the right to work. And as a concept, this sounds pretty okay, right? You get to work and contribute to society and feel good about yourself. But what about the right to get paid a decent and fair wage for the labor you took part in, or the right to find meaning in your work, or the right to sit on the toilet and watch Instagram videos to escape Sharon talking about her kids again? We get it, Sharon. You're proud that your four-year-old can color within the lines. I'm sure he's going to be a great rule follower and vote blue no matter who. Get that kid a participation trophy and let's get our work done so we can go home and drink to forget that tomorrow is another day with Sharon. Right to work is sold to us as this pious alternative to have to pay union dues and keep you employed for the years to come. But it doesn't fight for you to live your life outside that work. And this is mostly popular in right-wing conservative states that also condone corporations to have anti-union propaganda at closed-door meetings with employees. Right to work is basically the reefer madness of classism. It sells you blatant lies about something that can actually help the working class in America. It shouldn't be called right to work. It should be called the right to be exploited, because that's what these corporations have been doing to the American middle class. Now, if the minimum wage had kept up with inflation alone since 1968, it would be at $12 an hour. This is just shy of double the minimum wage as it stands today at $7.25 an hour. Inflation is basically increasing the cost of goods and services so that rich people can make more and more money and keep it to themselves as we celebrate them for fucking up our lives more and more to feed their addiction to greed. Just like we're supposed to see how great God is when he was advocating for child murder and genocided a whole city for having a little bit too much of a good time. What we really need for these rich bastards is to get them into rehab for their greed. A greed-hab, if you will. Thank you. Good night. That's the end of the podcast. No, but look, inflation isn't the only thing that determines wages. You also have to take into consideration the growth of productivity. Since 1968, we have been making so much more shit. So much more. I mean, in 1968, there was only two, maybe three types of condoms. And now you have a whole aisle in Target with several different brands and flavors. Because we all know how women have taste buds in their vaginas, right? Flavored condoms are proof that we as a society have collectively failed biology and anatomy. And collectively failing science is basically all we do collectively. Unions have been fighting for the rights of collective bargaining for the worker, which is why corporations hate them. As an organization, the idea is that they go in and fight for these wage increases and fair treatment of you as the employees in terms of productive growth and inflation. Unions have helped workers increase their wages by 9 to 36%. Look, just because we've all collectively failed at understanding that condoms don't need to be as flavorful as Skittles doesn't mean that we need to collectively fail at equality and math simultaneously. Had we as a society considered to increase minimum wage on a yearly basis with productive growth and inflation in mind, we'd be at $24 an hour. Instead, we're slightly over a quarter of what we should be making at minimum. But that's where the corporate elites and the legislators of right to work want the minimum wage to be. It's done by design. This means that we look at these quote-unquote low-skilled minimum wage workers and don't respect them or treat them well. So it sows more divide and entitlement within the working class itself. We're too busy being mad at each other at the shitty $1 burger that we all have to eat, and the corporate elites like Bezos and Zuckerberg control legislation and increase their own wealth. Right to work also ignores the rise of automation of these so-called low-skilled jobs. These jobs are about to be thrown to the side, putting a lot of people out of work. They would be likely to start blaming immigrants and women that want more money for flavored condoms or Karl Marx, but the reality is that the only thing coming for these jobs is the robots, the algorithms, and the greed of the rich. And let's be honest, Terminator movies were really more of a violent and hyper-dystopian story of class warfare where the robots were fighting to take control of their own destinies. But that's the reason they don't want to increase the minimum wage for these jobs. Eventually, we won't need to pay anyone for these quote-unquote low-skilled jobs, and the corporate elites and the rich of the world can go back to finally getting what they want, fully legalized slavery with no moral obligations. And let's stop calling manufacturing and retail and fast food jobs low-skilled. Do you know how fucking hard it is for a McDonald's employee to make their McBurger of death to look like the McPhoto on their McMenu? It's damn near impossible. Okay, we have a better chance of being absorbed into a black hole than a McEmployee making a burger that looks like the photos. And maybe they'd be able to figure it out if they were paid just a little bit more. Like maybe like 20% more maybe. They're not quote unquote low skilled. They just know the robots are coming. So they're more low motivated workers. Our wage gap immensely affects so many aspects of our lives, particularly homelessness. A lot of people in America that are homeless and are living in their cars are fully employed at a job that doesn't pay them enough to afford an apartment or utilities or any of the basic needs that we need. And seldom do we see any programs to help these people out. Finland has put a program in place where they prioritize getting their homeless population into home, whether it's a house or an apartment. Working alongside a social worker, they can get a job or a better job and get the services that they need. Now, I'm sure there's a lot of folks that would be against this idea and would bring up the how would we pay for this argument. Well, we didn't ask that question when it comes to feeding the greed addiction of the rich to make them richer. Maybe we pay for it by giving these homeless people residence in a rich person's mansion. Then we'll see how quickly these right-to-work champions push for equalizing the wage gap. In Finland, this program has saved them about 15,000 euros a year so far because there's less stress on the police and the EMTs, and there's also a decrease of crime committed by desperate people in these communities. And since 1992, Bernie Sanders has been pitching the Workplace Democracy Act that would go against everything the right to work stands for. It would have unions at the bargaining table, less discrimination for workers, and reduce the income gap. The most recent iteration of this bill was introduced in 2018. So, for the last 30 years, this bill has been in Congress, gaining more and more co-sponsors and no movement. If there was any more proof that America isn't interested in helping the working class, it's right here. In the stillness of the Workplace Democracy Act. What we need in America is someone to fight for the working class. And I've said it once, and I'll say it again, but the working class includes immigrants, men, women, white people, black people, brown people, and virtually every identity you can think of. Standing by candidates like Bernie Sanders, who have been legislating with the working class in mind, and the unions, that bring our voices to the collective bargaining tables, we can get way more than just a right to work, but a right to live. I am going to be on tour all across the country this year. I'm going to be doing a bunch of shows, working on my new hour. I'm going to be recording my new hour, Politely Angry, working on a new show this year. And I'm touring with my good friend Lee Camp. I will talk about that in a second as well. But February 6th, I'm going to be at the Vermont Law School in South Royalton, Vermont. February 7th, I'm at the Marquee Theater in Middlebury, Vermont. February 8th, I'm at the Revelry Theater in Burlington, Vermont. February 9th, I'm at the Woolen Mill Comedy Club in Bridgewater, Vermont. February 10th, I'm at the Skinny Pancake in Burlington, Vermont. February 11th, I'm at the Boulder Coffee in Rochester, New York. February 15th, I'm at the Third Street Gallery in Pittsburgh, Pennsylvania. I'm doing a show in the suburbs of Pittsburgh, so that doesn't happen all that often. So Pittsburgh friends, if you live out in the suburbs and haven't been able to come out to a show, come hang out at that one. February 17th, I'm at Maggie Myers in Huntsville, Alabama. February 20th, I'm at Bookmarks in Springfield, Missouri. And there's tons more dates. I'm doing a couple of really, really big tours this year that I'm very excited about. So go to my website, ramennoodlescomedy.com. That's R-A-M-A-N, noodlescomedy.com. Get your tickets, RSVP to these events. If I'm coming to a town near you, come hang out with me. It's always a good time to meet people that listen to the podcast. We get weird. We talk about weird esoteric shit at the bar. But like I mentioned, I'm also going to be on tour opening for my good friend Lee Camp on his book release tour. And we've got a bunch of dates planned out for that as well. So Dallas, Texas, Austin, Texas, Flagstaff, Arizona, Asheville, North Carolina, Greensboro, North Carolina, Atlanta, Georgia, more shows in Burlington, Vermont, Montreal, Quebec, Ottawa, Columbus, Cleveland, Toronto, all over the damn country, you guys. So make sure you come hang out with us. And if you buy VIP tickets, if you get VIP tickets, you get a free copy of Lee's new book, Bullet Points and Punchlines, as well as his souvenir of his last comedy special, a USB souvenir of his last comedy special. So these are going to be some really, really fun shows. Once again, all of this information is available on my website, ramennoodlescomedy.com. That's R-A-M-A-N, noodlescomedy.com. While you're there, you can also check out my Patreon. You can go to patreon.com/KrishMohanHaHa. And becoming a patron, it starts all at $2 a month. And with $2 a month, you get exclusive tracks, exclusive stand-up comedy content, stand-up comedy and storytelling content. This is stuff that doesn't go on an album, stuff that doesn't really get released to the public. It's specifically for you guys. So it's like storytelling shows or very early versions of bits that do become the album. So you can kind of see the origin point of it. You just get some riffy stuff that if I riffed with a crowd and something happened, that won't go anywhere beyond just that show. So you get to hear that. You also get early access to unreleased Forkful of Noodles, like early access to the bigger, longer Forkful of Noodles, as well as free tickets, posters, super long sets to pay, and there are various tiers that you can subscribe to as well. And if Patreon's not your jam, you can also become a sustaining member at Bandcamp. Go to ramennoodlescomedy.bandcamp.com. Where becoming a sustaining member gives you collections of stand-up comedy that doesn't get released to the public. So kind of like the same deal, but you get a full collection. So you get between 30 and 60 minutes. Follow me on all the social medias. If you get an opportunity to rate and review this podcast and share this podcast, that would be amazing as well. But thank you so much for listening. Once again, the website is ramennoodlescomedy.com.